Do you want to get real management consulting insights from a strategy consultant? Then this Q&A session is for you. Hi everyone, my name is Johannes and welcome to this channel. Welcome to Mastering Consulting. On this channel, I want to help you to learn the necessary skills to be both successful in your management consulting career while at the same time living a balanced life. And today we have a great Q&A session, 60 minutes long. I received some questions up front and also I opened the live chat and will answer questions that I received during the live. So I hope you will enjoy this and let's go. So one of the questions that I received up front was, and Baniflex, I think this is very similar to the question that you have. One of the question was, any piece of advice to a break into consulting with an MBA? And this is a very common question that I get. So if I pursue an MBA, what are my recommendations to join the consulting industry? Well, first of all, you may need to make sure that you have, you know, great academic results during that MBA program. Okay, so I think this is, you know, obviously very important. Besides that, you should focus on getting practical experience in terms of valuable internships. Okay, so if you want to be a part of the strategy consulting sector very soon, then obviously it makes sense to do an internship at, you know, the MBB firms or, you know, tier two firms, boutique firms, so that you can prove that you already have some practical experience in the strategy sector. If you say, okay, you want to join the big four consultancies, then obviously you should make sure that during your intern program that you gain practical experience at one of the big four firms. Okay, so first of all, focus on your grades. Second, you need to get practical experience. Third, obviously you should prepare for case interviews. Okay, so once you say, okay, in the next 3 or 4 months I actually, you know, have my interviews, then you should start preparing your case study skills and doing, you know, preparation for the mental math part and so on. And then last but not least, I think this is very important, it's also important to develop consulting skills, okay? And I think especially in the beginning, this means that you should, you know, brush up your Excel skills, your PowerPoint skills, but also you should learn about basic organization and communication techniques, okay? So this is what I would recommend to you, okay? So Baniflex asks, I have 6 years of experience with talent acquisition and business development. Okay, and you're pursuing currently an MBA and you want to join the consulting industry. Well, as I said, so if you already have like experience in talent acquisition and business development, so the one is a HR topic, the other one is more like a sales topic, then I would try, you know, to get additional experience in a broader field. So especially if you want to join, for example, the strategy sector, then you should make, you should kind of, you know, broaden your portfolio by probably getting some practical experience in one of the MBB firms. Okay, so I would go for an internship if I were you, plus obviously all the additional topics that I mentioned before. Next question, Moritz1G asks, how to be successful in management consulting? Well, Moritz, so this is a very general question. I think it highly depends on the level that you are currently in, okay? I would say that if you are on a consultant level or junior consultant level, okay, so your main task is probably to support your consulting team by, you know, as a consultant, taking responsibility over a work stream, or at least, you know, having a strong responsibility over deliverables. So I think there's a kind of, you know, a skill pyramid, and one thing that is very important at the beginning, as I just said, you need to make sure that your PowerPoint skills, that your Excel skills, that they are very solid, okay? After that, focus on organization and communication, okay? This is, those are the basics, okay? You really need to master that. So the further you get, so for an example, if you are a consultant and if you are leading your own stream, then it becomes also very important, you know, to develop stakeholder management skills, that you also work on your problem solving skills, okay? And after that, if you are a, I mean, this change when you become a project manager, obviously, then you need to, you know, work on your project management skills. You also need to work on your leadership skills. You need to work on your storytelling skills. And slowly but surely, you also need to work on your business development skills. Okay, and once you are a partner, of course, there are many stages in between, but those are the main three ones. And your focus is very much on, you know, business development, network building, selling, and also the strategic development of the company. Okay, and that's why, you know, it's very hard to say what it takes to be successful in consulting, because it highly depends on the level that you are in. But overall, you also could add that work-life balance is very important, because in every stage, I mean, if you don't take care of your work-life balance and your health and your well-being, then chances are very high that you will quit consulting very, very soon. Afro King Fosu asks, I have 9 years of experience in administrative service, recently obtaining a Master of Science in Procurement and Supply. Do I stand a chance of getting into management consulting with my background? Of course you have. I mean, there are various people with various backgrounds in management consulting, okay? So I think it's always the most important that you show that you, you know, that you can prove an outstanding performance, both professionally, so in, with your practical experience, but also in your academic experience, okay? And then I would say the type of studies that you do, your university program is not that important. Of course, I mean, if you want to join MBB, so the strategy consultant consulting, and you know, the most renowned consulting firms, obviously it's very important there to, you know, have a degree from a renowned target university. Of course, this helps. But Afro King Fosu, you know, the field of management consulting is so broad that I, you know, almost guarantee you that you can find a job in the sector, although it might be hard sometimes, you know, to join MBB. But I don't know your grades, I don't know your practical experience, so this highly depends, okay? But of course, you know, you have a chance to join the management consulting industry. Okay, Bunnyflex asks, if I want to jump into consulting, how to select better business schools in UK? Well, there is one site that everyone refers to, and this is the Financial Times Business School Ranking. And I mean, if you are in England, then obviously, I mean, I didn't study in England, but then Oxford, Cambridge, obviously, London Business School, Warwick, I mean, there are many great business schools in England, okay? But the source that, you know, most people use as a reference is the Financial Times Business School Ranking, okay? And this is what I would look out for. Okay, one question is, Johannes, can you talk about things that you wished you knew before starting your career in management consulting? And yes, there is a thing. And I think the biggest mistake that I made was that in the first 2 years, I really strongly focused on, you know, skill development. And I thought, you know, I want to become so good that I get promoted and, you know, I make a big career no matter what. But I, you know, I kind of forgot about one important factor, and this was, you know, focusing on relationship management and building relationships. And the longer you are in consulting, the more you realize that having good relationships is the key, you know, to have success in management consulting. So there's a saying that says a consultant is only as good as his business network. Okay, and this is true for, you know, many reasons. So first of all, obviously, you want to have very good relationships with your company and your teammates, because, you know, you are on a mission together, you know, you want to support each other. And it's very important, you know, to have this kind of bonding to get through tough times during the project. Okay, so you want to build great relationships within your team and within your company. Okay, within your company, because you want to access know-how and resources. Obviously, the other part is that you also want to develop a external network. Okay, so to friends who work in different industries, to, you know, people with different backgrounds, because once you need information, once you want to access information, it's very good to have a few people within your personal network that you can quickly ask for their opinion or for their advice. And so that's the second bucket in terms of relationship and building and networking. And the third bucket, obviously, is building relationships and a network to the client. And this means, you know, not only the top management, but only, you know, middle management and maybe some, you know, promising junior guys, so that you actively build a potential client network from the very, very beginning. And the biggest mistake, and this is probably something I wish I knew before I started management consulting, was, you know, how important those three networking buckets really are. And this is probably a mistake that I made at the beginning. And if I would start over again, I would definitely focus more on relationship building from the very beginning. Again, you know, skills are important, analytical skills are very important. It's important that you are driven and that you are very structured. But don't forget, you know, the kind of soft part. Don't forget the relationship building during your work, because even in a highly competitive industry like management consulting, you know, we are only humans, and obviously humans like to, you know, work together with other humans who want to build good and deep relationships. Another question that I received up front: so what is my definition of being a good management consultant? And I made a video about that. And what I like to do is, you know, I always like to compare a management consultant to a doctor, okay? Because actually it's very similar. And if you want to answer for yourself, you know, how you define a good consultant, then think about how would you define a good doctor for yourself, okay? And obviously a doctor is someone, you know, where you can go to, who has a very, very structured problem solving approach. Okay, you get there and, you know, he does all of this analysis and he gets to the right result no matter what. Okay, you would definitely expect that from a doctor. Also, you would expect the doctor, you know, to have a very modern equipment, to have the most modern tools, okay, to have access to the right expert if he needs to access them. So this is probably a second thing. The third thing is that you want the doctor to be very, you know, to have a very high empathy level, okay? Because obviously, you know, you're talking about very sensitive information, and thus, you know, you want to also, you know, have a doctor that you can get along with on a very personal level. And I think those are more or less the three things that I would, or how I would define a good consultant. Okay, so it's first, you know, having a very good and very structured problem-solving approach. Then it's second, you know, to have access to all the knowledge that we need. And third, you know, to be also able to build a good relationship with the client and to be able, you know, to communicate your ideas in the right way. So this is how I personally probably would define being a good consultant. Cesar asked me up front, so what is the thing that I love the most about management consulting? And that is a question that I get asked, you know, very often. And I would say the thing that I love the most is, you know, the personal growth aspect. So there are many categories where you are almost forced, you know, to grow during your consulting career, okay? So this is in terms of, you know, your hard skills, obviously. So, you know, you have to improve your problem-solving skills. Obviously, you have to learn how to use all the tools. You learn a lot about management, how to do analysis and that stuff. So you constantly, you know, develop very, very good hard skills for management. Also, you develop very good soft skills, okay? So you learn how to communicate, you need to learn how to organize yourself, you know, how to network, how to sell. This is also very important as a management consultant. So you have also a very steep learning curve there. And besides that, you know, you build a great network with very aspiring peers, you know, who push you further, who, you know, give you great input, who are just cool people to hang around with. Also, obviously, on the client side, so not only on your team side, this is also a great aspect. And, you know, also the traveling lifestyle, obviously, you know, seeing various industries, various clients, various companies also obviously helps, you know, to grow. So I would say that, you know, on those four levels, there is a very, very high personal growth aspect in a career of management consulting. And although there are many other benefits, you know, like exit opportunities, you know, salary, stuff like that, I think, you know, the personal growth aspect is kind of the most important for me personally, okay? And this is what I really love about management consulting, that like every week, I learn something new. Actually, every day I learn something new, and every day I'm pushed a bit further on my limits. And this is something I enjoy really much, because especially in the first years of your professional career, this is it's a great asset. It's a great training program actually for whatever you want to do after your consulting career. Bunnyflex asks, what are the business opportunities if you are in management consulting? Well, Bunnyflex, I think you are talking about career opportunities, right? And so basically, there's the kind of obvious part path. So this means that you stay within a consulting firm. And obviously, this means that, you get on a partner track. Okay, so this is like obviously the most obvious path that you can take in management consulting. And this means, that you're responsible for selling projects, that you build relationships to clients, that you oversee projects. And what you need there is, having very strong sales skills. But it's also a very demanding job, okay? So it's very time consuming, and most partners work still very long hours, probably a bit less than the junior staff, but still they're working very hard. But obviously it's a great paid job. It's a very exciting job where you travel a lot, meet different people. So, but this is the one path that you can take. And then there are many other paths. So one thing that is very common is that, people from the consulting industry join, for example, private equity or venture capital, because, this is something where you can earn more than in management consulting, because you're more on the investment side. So this is a typical career path. Many people also join corporates, so, join strategic or middle management functions in the big companies. And there are others, who join the startup industry. So I would say that those are typically the career exit or the career paths as a management consultant. Then another question that I received was, how is your typical workday as a management consultant? And as a caveat, so there is no typical workday as a management consultant, okay? So usually, not every day is different, but it's a very dynamic environment, okay? And depending on the project, depending, on the country, depending on the project phase, on the industry, on your task, on your team, etc., on your role. So your days can look very, very different from time to time. So, but if I had to lay out a blueprint, okay, I would say that my days usually look like the following. And so I get up around between 7 and 8, okay? This is so my time when I get up. Then I usually have 1 hour morning routine where I do some meditation, I read, I do a visualization exercise. Sometimes I do a short workout, take a cold shower and take breakfast, okay? So this is my morning routine. And after that, as in most projects, you have start a day with a check-in, okay? So this is, let's say in my current project, it's a quarter to 9. Then we have a short check-in call with the entire team, where the partner says a few words, where the project manager says a few words about important events and next steps. And then usually the day starts around 9, let's say, okay? And then what I do is, so I like to divide my workday into 3 phases, okay? So the first work phase is between 9 and let's say 1. The other one is from 2 until let's say 6. And the third work phase is from let's say 7 until 10 or 11, okay? Depending how long you work. And those are the 3 work blocks. In between, obviously, you have lunch and you have your dinner. And this means that you have 3 main slots where you do all the work. And I try to structure it the following way. Okay, so my morning block, so between 9 and 1, this is usually the time where you have the where you have the highest concentration level. So this means I try to do the most difficult tasks there. I also try put all the important meetings in the morning, because this is the time where I'm the most productive. Then in the afternoon, this is usually the time where I'm the least productive. Okay, so after lunch, usually you're getting tired, so it's pretty tough. So this is usually where I try to do, you know, less important meetings. I also like to do there, you know, more creative work, especially if I have to create storylines or presentations, or if I just have to read through documents, okay? So this is what I usually like to do in the afternoon. And then in the evening, I like to, you know, again, because concentration level is again a bit higher. So in the evening, I personally like, you know, to work on the deliverables. So if I have to work on a presentation, this is usually a time where you don't have meetings. So, you know, you have some time to concentrate. Also in the evening, you usually do most of your internal team meetings because the entire project team is available for calls or for personal meetings. And those are usually the tasks that I do in the evening. Okay, so and your break, so to say, usually your lunch break, I don't know, depending on the project, is somewhere between 12 and 2 probably. If you're at the client side, I try to, you know, have lunch with my teammates or with the client, okay, so never eat alone. Then in the evening, you usually, you know, go back to the hotel around 6 or 7, I would say. Then you have dinner at the hotel with the team. And then some people, you know, if they have time, do sports in the evening, but I usually do it in the morning. So this would be a typical work day in my life as a management consultant, but as a caveat, as I mentioned, so I mean, it's very hard to generalize on that, okay? So there are two exceptions. So one is obviously Monday if you travel to the client side, and the other one is obviously Thursday, okay, so if you leave, and Friday is usually office Friday. So on Monday it's a bit different, so you usually get up around 5 or 6, you take an early plane to the client, and then you arrive at the client side, you know, around 10, maybe 9, so the day starts a bit later there. Then on Thursday, you usually drive home, you take a plane, let's say between 6 in the evening and 9 in the evening back to your home city, and you probably, you know, stop working a bit earlier. And then Friday, you usually work only until, let's say, 6 p.m. depending on your project. So this is, you know, office Friday, and weekends hopefully are off. Okay, so this is kind of, you know, a blueprint of a typical consulting week, but again, there, you know, this is only a blueprint, and you know, the exception is the rule, but I hope this helped. Norman asks, maybe off topic, how do you handle a rebellious team as a project leader? Okay, Norman, so the question is, what is a rebellious team? So I would say in consulting, if you have a rebellious team, then you made some mistakes as a project leader, okay? And usually this is the case when, you know, the team is working too hard, okay? So if the project manager is not able to kind of, you know, manage the stakeholders, meaning the client and the partner and all the tasks involved, then usually the team ends up, you know, working very, very long hours. And this is usually the time where, you know, the team loses trust in the project manager, and this is where they get rebellious. So I would say, you know, your task as a project manager then is that you build trust again, and that you manage your workload, you know, right. And I think this is very important. Otherwise, I mean, there are cases where you just have, like, you know, difficult consultants because, you know, they have very big egos or, you know, something like that. But usually it's very easy to get rid of them because, you know, if, you know, they're not acting in a professional way, then they usually don't have a place in management consulting, to be honest, okay? So I would say the team is most of the time only rebellious, you know, if the project manager made a mistake. So this is, you know, then easy to handle. And if there are some, you know, consultants who, you know, stand apart the line, then it's, you know, if they're not behaving in a professional way, then it's probably very easy to take them off the project. That's what I would say. Dyke asks, when I remember right, you founded a consultancy while studying. Yes, Maybe you can share some stories and insights about founding a own consultancy. Yes, Dyke, of course I can. So it was, I mean, I was in a student consulting club. So, and if you're familiar with the concept in Germany, so those are, you know, consulting clubs founded by students. And those students, they conduct real projects with real clients, okay, for money, obviously. And I was very, very active in some of those consulting clubs, okay? And through that, I already was able, because I was responsible for business development, I was able, you know, to already, you know, build a kind of business network during my studies. And through my business network, I got the chance, you know, to acquire a project. That project led to another project, and you know, after a couple of weeks, actually, I had like three projects in the pipeline, and that was where I said, okay, you know, I found my own consultancy. I mean, it was very. It's an easy step in Germany to find a consultancy, because it's from a legal perspective, it's very easy to do that. And yeah, that's what I did. And I hired a couple of consultants, but only part-time. Okay, so I had no full-time employees. It was more project-based work. So because I needed some people to share the work with, so I hired them on a part-time basis. Okay, yeah, that's what I did. And what I learned there is, you know, actually how to build a network, okay? And I think this is very important. So you need a network in order to sell the projects. If you don't have a network, and if you don't have potential clients in the pipeline, I wouldn't start the business, because otherwise, you know, you know, building a network takes time. And whatever you're doing at the moment, I would rather recommend you to work on your network and to build a network before founding your own consultancy. I think this is very crucial. And is age a important factor if you join the consulting industry? No, to be honest, I don't think that age matters, because, you know, the backgrounds of different people are so diverse. You know, we have people like those genius people, you know, who graduated, you know, 2 years earlier with a plus degree, you know, because they're just a genius. You have those people, and those are typically very young. On the other hand, you also have, you know, late starters who, like I, you know, did. Studied something else before, but it doesn't matter. And you also have very senior people. So I have people, you know, who are senior associates, so senior consultant at my company, who are like 5 years older than I am. But the reason for that was that because they worked, you know, in a corporate for a very, very long time, then they did their PhD and so on. So I wouldn't say that age plays a big role. I mean, of course, you know, always compare yourself with your peers. I mean, if you are like, you know, 40 and you're completing your, you know, master's degree, of course, this is something, you know, the recruiter will ask you about. But I don't think that this is a showstopper, okay? So yeah, I wouldn't say that age plays a big role, to be honest. Good, Moritz asks, why did you go? Okay, I like the story with your own consulting company a lot. Why did you go into another consulting firm instead of pursuing to develop your own company? That's a very good question, Moritz. And the answer is that, well, I think the answer is that, I always take it from a learning curve perspective, okay? And obviously, I could start directly with my own company, and I could have started to scale my own company. But I said, okay, I want to get some experience at a, you know, a top-notch consulting level first, before I do that, because you know, the truth is, and if I look back, it was totally the right decision, you know, because I'm now working with top executives, and I would not have gotten those contacts if I started from scratch, you know, because you know, if you want to do like, you know, top profile, high notch strategy consulting projects, it's very, very hard to build that network, and this takes like 5 to 10 years. And it's much easier if you start in a consultancy that already has those contacts and take that as a starting point, I would say. And you know, if I look back the past 3 years, it was the right decision because all the learnings I made in terms of, you know, my analytical skills, in terms of my communication skills, my networking skills, I think this is a very, very good foundation. And I feel much more comfortable now to, conduct projects, to lead projects, and also to sell projects than I did like 3 to 4 years ago, you know, when I graduated. So that was the reason. But I have very strong entrepreneurial tendencies. I'm now building the Mastering Consulting channel as a side business. Maybe I will, you know, think about my own consultancy in the future. But at the moment, I rather focus on, the career path within my company. Yeah, hope this answers your question. Okay, Moreno asked me, how important are interpersonal skills in leadership positions? And obviously, they are very important. So, you know, empathy and, you know, reading people and understanding people, and especially understanding what people need at certain stages of their career is so crucial. Okay, so I think this is probably one of the most important skills in terms of leadership, okay? That you have empathy, that you're, you know, able to read people, that you have a very high social and emotional intelligence. Because at the end, that's all, you know, what leadership is all about, you know, to lead people and to deal with people. And you cannot force them, so you need to convince them. And this is most of the time much easier if you're able to touch their hearts, okay? So I would say interpersonal skills in leadership are crucial and very important. Norman asks, do you think that NLP, so neuro-linguistic programming, is a pseudoscience? I don't know. to be honest, so I like to read NLP techniques and like to read about it because I think it's very important. So I do believe in programming my own mind, okay? So I, you know, highly believe in, you know, that you are able to change your emotional state. I do believe that, you know, you can apply certain techniques to get in a certain emotional state. But I cannot judge if this is a real science or a pseudoscience. You know, this whole personal development sector and NLP sector, it's, you know, it's so difficult because I think in general those topics are very important and you know, there's they're very valuable. But there's so much crap out there and there are so many, wrong people who, you know, promise things that they cannot keep. And, you know, I think the entire industry and LMP and coaching industry is, you know, a bit fucked up. So I think it's very hard to really find the, you know, the few diamonds within the industry that really help you. So, but in general, I would say, you know, NLP and, you know, personal development and coaching, can be very valuable. But you have to put in the work and you have to, you know, find the diamonds within the industry. You know, I paid a lot of money for coachings and I even did a NLP seminar once. So that's my take on it. Good, everyone. So if you have more questions, then please write a comment in the chat and I will get back to you as soon as possible. Also, if you like the video, then please leave a thumb up and make sure to subscribe. And that's it for today. Tomorrow there will be a new live session on Instagram and I will upload the video afterwards on YouTube. So with that being said, I want to thank you for your time. Hope you have a successful week. Wish you all the best. Goodbye, Johannes.